Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I'd like to welcome you to the regular City Commission meeting, City of Deltona, for Monday, August 1st, 2016. Ask City Clerk, please call the roll.
Commissioner Herzberg?
Present.
Commissioner Honaker? Commissioner
Schleicher? He's excused.
Here.
Commissioner Smith?
Here.
Commissioner Sukup?
Here.
Vice Mayor Nabik?
Happy to be here.
Mayor Masarzyk?
Here. All right, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to turn the meeting over to Commissioner Diane Smith for the invocation, the pledge, and the singing of our national anthem. Commissioner Smith?
Thank you, Mayor. We'll first stand for a silent invocation, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance. And following the pledge, we're honored to have Elizabeth Hibbert from the Youth Performing Arts Training Center. She's also a student at Reading Edge Academy. Sing for us this evening. So thank you. Please stand. Thank you.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets rang
Thank you. Great job. Thank you, Commissioner Smith, also. Commissioners, next item on the agenda is approval of our special City Commission and regular City Commission meetings of July 18th. There's no corrections, additions, deletion, motions in order.
So moved. Are we using?
All right. Properly moved by Commissioner Herzberg. Commissioner Schleicher?
Second.
Okay, thank you all. Moving on.
You have to vote.
Oh, I'm sorry. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Is anyone opposed? All right, we'll use the voting for other items on the agenda, but that's it for there. Next item on the agenda is a presentation of quarterly reports for city advisory boards. Most of those are written reports that are there. Is Tanya Boggs here? Tanya is going to give a report on Economic Development Advisory Board, and it's going to be followed by a three-minute video on economic development. Tanya, you have the floor.
Good evening. Just a quick report for the second quarter. We had three meetings, of course, one each month, April, May, and June. One of the primary focuses was the Flex Theme Accelerator, which you're going to see upcoming in a new report and recommendation in the next few months. So we hope to have that to you very soon. We had City Manager Shang visit us talking about branding. We had Chris Boley visit us talking about the new center at Deltona. Both very exciting. We also worked quite a bit with Bethune-Cookman this quarter, talking about their entrepreneur degree program, learning from that and how that influences workforce development, as well as visiting and taking a tour of their facilities there and learning how that can impact the workforce as well.
Okay, you all been busy.
We have. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. City Manager Shang has a video, I think, that's going to be presented by Lee.
Hello, I'm Commissioner Heidi Hertzberg, representing District 3 in the city of Deltona. 2016 is proving to be a milestone year for Deltona, with high-visibility new projects in progress, as well as major improvements to the city's infrastructure. One of the most exciting new projects is the construction of the new Deltona Community Center to be located in the Howland Crossings Business Park. The 29,000-square-foot building will have banquet and meeting space, a performing stage, offices, catering kitchen facilities, in addition to a garden area for exterior receptions. The center will also be home for Deltona's seniors' activities. The community center is planned for a December 2017 dedication. In the same northwest quadrant, the activity center, Halifax Hospital is building its newest medical hub, Halifax Health at Halifax Crossing. The planned medical facility will begin with a freestanding emergency care and full service imaging center with a completion date of December 2016. The next phase includes doctor office space as well as support services to open in spring 2017. Halifax Health is also planning on a December 2016 opening for its Bella Vista Medical Complex, located near the intersection of Howland Boulevard and State Road 415. Along the north shore of Lake Monroe, work will soon begin on the Lakeshore Loop Multi-Use Trail. This pedestrian and bike-friendly trail connects with the River-to-Sea Bicycle Trail at Thornby Park and brings visitors to the shore of Lake Monroe. The trail continues in front of the Deltona boat ramp and docks and meets up with the River-to-Sea Trail again in the Green Springs Park. One of Deltona's first business centers along its namesake thoroughfare, Deltona Boulevard, was recently approved as a community redevelopment area. Now, the city will be able to direct tax revenue back to improvements that will bring commercial activity and new businesses to the area. In the same area designated as part of the CRA, Saxon Boulevard east of Interstate 4, Deltona will add commercial sewer service. The installation of this utility will allow for new commercial development along one of the city's major gateway corridors. This extension of commercial sewer is a direct result of Deltona's new Eastern Water Reclamation Facility on State Road 415. The plant was dedicated in late 2015 and is now fully online, also providing reclaimed water for the city's residents. This expansion of Deltona's utility is one part of the infrastructure improvements seen throughout the city. More than 20 separate street projects are in different stages of completion, making significant upgrades to Deltona's roadways. The city is investing $18 million in these projects, bringing the condition of its surface roads up to par with its neighboring municipalities. In addition to the improvements to its roads and utilities, Deltona is in the process of a citywide beautification program that includes the demolition of abandoned and unsightly structures, as well as revising and enforcing the city's solid waste ordinances. This project was the result of resident input, what they saw as important to their hometown. The program kicked off last year with Beautify Deltona with major upgrades to landscaping at many city facilities. This prompted residents to follow suit, renovating and cleaning up their own homes and yards, and is still an ongoing effort. Earlier this year, abandoned homes were identified for demolition, with the first coming down in March. With the clearing of these dangerous structures, neighborhoods now had the opportunity to continue with the cleanup, raising the residents' quality of life as well as their property values. Deltona is also partnering with the Department of Transportation on the Bold Initiative program, landscaping another one of Deltona's major gateways, Howland Boulevard going east of Interstate 4, the same location for the new Halifax Health Medical Hub. It was decided that it was time for Deltona to be seen in a new and better light to rebrand the city. And now we're Deltona, a city on the move. With the new projects and improvements, Deltona is moving forward, ready for all of the opportunities the future will bring. I'm Commissioner Heidi Hertzberg with the City of Deltona. Thank you.
Good job, Heidi. Good job. Looks really good. Nice job. It was all in one take, too. We heard you, Commissioner. Great job. That really looked good. Okay, we'll move on to special reports. Heidi, you had mentioned you had a report last time.
I didn't. It was actually this. It was the King of Volusia.
Okay.
This video was produced for the city. We did the city updates, and they do this periodically with Team Volusia and showcase the cities. And this time, we were one of, I believe, five that were there that day. We were the only one with a video, and it was extremely well received. It was everyone commented on how professional it was done, the quality of the video itself, and how we have an amazing in-house video production. So it went over very, very well. That was the report that I wanted to talk about.
All right, thank you. Did a great job. It really looks good. We need to get that playing on the TV as much as we can. All right, the next item on, are there no other commissioners have any special reports? Being none, we'll go to public forum for people that have something that's not on agenda they want to speak about.
Susan Collins.
Even though she...
Name and address.
Okay. Yeah. Susan Collins, 3201 North Tulsa Drive. I emailed you all earlier today about no U-turn signs on Howland Boulevard. And I had last year brought it up. And too many people are making U-turns where they shouldn't be making U-turns, closer to the high school. And there was one other place along that route from Providence to I-4, and I can't remember that street. But I'm constantly, well, everybody's constantly using that road. And you're always slowing down for somebody making a U-turn in the fast lane and going, waiting for the cars on the other side to get through. And then they're holding up traffic. Two Saturdays ago, I was going to Home Depot to learn how to tile floors. And a gentleman, I was driving, there was a car in front of me, and then there was a man who wanted to do the U-turn right near the Dunkin' Donuts. I had another person. Both lanes were full. And then at the same time that guy was making a U-turn, there was a person actually making a right-hand turn in that driveway, sorry, the street, to go into Dunkin' Donuts, that side street. So we've had the two people making turns, two cars, me, another car, and another car. I couldn't get over. Everybody was slowing down. Nobody was really speeding, but the person gave us to a complete stop. So the white car is a complete stop. I'm at a complete stop. These people kind of rolled through. I said, okay, this guy's taking forever. I'm just going to go in the other lane. I look in my rearview mirror to go make a turn, see if I can make a turn. There is a SUV coming down like 50, 60 miles an hour. I swear to God, I thought I was going to get hit. It scared the living daylights out of me. And I just, you know, I know that... Sorry. When I brought it up before, Mayor John did take it to the county, and the county said not enough people are complaining about it. Well, how many people have to get hurt before you complain about it and get a sign? It's a sign that says no U-turn. Right now, 100% of the people say I can make a turn there. There's no room, not on that angle. There's a good angle for when people are coming from the Dunkin' Donuts, and they're coming across two lanes. There's enough angle to go that way. There's a U-turn, a left-hand turn going into it from the other side. That makes sense. It's just not safe. I've seen many people slowing down, going around. Whenever I can go over, I go over. This time I couldn't go over. I thought I was going to die because this guy was coming by so fast. Right. And I was...
Okay, you're all emotional about it, and I understand that. But go ahead, just take your time. We'll wait on you. Just
okay.
Take your time.
So, all I could think of is I'm going to be eating my steering wheel in about 2 seconds. I'm thinking, God, what is this impact going to feel like? I'm a sitting duck because this idiot wants to make a U-turn, probably to get into the car wash. You know, and it's not safe there. I don't want to be the person who dies or gets paralyzed or loses a limb before a survey is done. I understand you want surveys. I get it. But it's just a sign that can save people's lives, because some people are just too retarded to not go up 500 feet and do the U-turn at Wolfpack Road. That's all the person had to do. I've never made a U-turn on that street, ever. I've gone up to Racetrack to turn around. If I decided, I don't want to go, I'm too tired to drive, I'll go over to Racetrack, turn around, and come back. So I just want, if we can just sidestep the survey, it just seems so ridiculous.
We'll have to notify the county. It's a county road, so we'll have to notify them. But like I said, their normal answer is they'll survey the traffic. But I think if we ask them, I'm sure Ms. Shank can get a letter off to the county and ask them to put a no U-turn sign, because it's been causing a problem.
I mean, how many people? You know, I always have something to say, and I'll come and complain. Some people just won't come, so it's just going to delay it.
It's a good point. All right, thank you very much.
Oh, you're welcome. Okay. Thank you for listening. You all have a good evening.
Okay. Jane, can you do that, Jerry Britton, to see if he can't put some no U-turn signs? Because it is hard. In my truck, yours, it's hard to make that.
Sure, and I've already forwarded the request to the Sheriff's Department.
All right.
Robert Schenber.
Good evening. How are you?
Fine. Your name and address, please.
My name is Robert Schenber. I live at 1375 Indian Rock Court, which is basically just on the other side of the street in Deltona Hills in the golf course area.
Right.
I purchased the home in January. I love golf. It was a great house. It's on the seventh hole of the golf course. I get to watch the golfers come by, all that good stuff. There's a home next to mine at 1385. I'm not against this woman. I haven't met her. She's an elderly woman. The last I heard, she lives in the Villages out in Central Florida. The house is filled with a lot of stuff. And in the last 2 days, we've had a lot of lightning. I watched guys tee off on the fourth tee box, and they hit their balls down, and I'm like, wow. I looked up at the sky, and I'm like, man, that's not good. A huge bolt of lightning came down, like 400 yards from them. The reason I'm here is the house is filled with a lot of stuff. She doesn't want to maintain the property. She owns it outright. There's no banks involved. She physically owns the property. But she's not maintaining it. Once again, so we're clear, I'm not against this woman. I've not even met her. I moved in January. But we live in the United States of America here. You cannot just own a piece of property and not maintain it.
Can you go into more detail of what you mean? You say she has a lot of stuff. What do you mean by maintaining? The grass not being mowed, stuff like that?
No, she has a gentleman that comes over and mows the grass. No problem there.
Okay.
The pool is filled with about 10,000 gallons of green water. There's a hole in the screen, so I have this regular blue heron that comes down, and he pecks at the pool, toads, tadpoles, whatever.
Okay.
He gets his food, he goes. But the house is number one, it's a fire hazard. Number two, the pool is completely filled with 10,000 gallons of green water, and one of these fine 10 pictures on the wall of older past city commissioners wrote an ordinance that stated that you're not allowed to have a dirty pool in your backyard. Is city manager Ms.
Shank?
Ms. Shank, is there an ordinance?
Sir, you have to direct your comments to me, but okay. You
I'm
just want
sure.
Someone. We'll send somebody out to look at the house. That's what you're asking for.
I am asking for that, but okay. I'm also asking for this woman to be located, because it goes a lot further than that. The case has been handed off to a judge magistrate. She's got well over $80,000 of code enforcement fines on the property.
Oh, it's already, okay.
Oh, it goes way, way past that. And the time has come, because the Zika virus is down in Miami-Dade County, and it's moving slowly, slowly north, okay?
Right.
And in about a year and a half to 2 years, we're going to have an influx of 900,000 people coming from the island of Puerto Rico. Are you aware of that?
Sir, I don't want to comment on that. I'm just saying that what we'll do is we'll get code enforcement to give us a printout. Maybe you can have them send it to all the commissioners. We'll find out what the status is, and they have to contact the owner, because they've had to bring her before the special magistrate. And the fines, if fines are being in place, That's all we could do so far. We'll have to find out. Then we'll look into the idea of the pool. If it's a hazard, then we'd have to get permission to go on the property and do something about it.
Can you answer me one question? I was told that a city or a municipality can only take code enforcement fines up to a certain fiscal amount, and then they have to stop charging the fines.
Every city has their own ordinance on how they do that. So, no, I can't answer that for every city. Here in Deltona, we have a fine, an ordinance that sets it up, but we'll have to get an update from staff. I can't speak, staff's not here, get an update from staff on exactly what the caseload is on this house and where they're at with it.
Okay,
we need to do that first, but you brought up a good point. If nothing else, we've got
to
spray
it. It is right next door to my house.
Right.
You can come and knock on my front door. If my car is there, I drive a white Toyota 4Runner. It's got a bunch of stickers on one window. You can't miss it. All if right. I am there, I will come out, and we can take a tour around this house, and you can see what I'm talking about. But it goes a little bit further than that. Number one, this is a health hazard. Number two, my children just moved up here from Palm Beach County, and this is what we have. I also feel that the realtor lied to me when we were going through the negotiations of purchasing the home. So now I think I've been swindled by Watson Realty.
Well, okay, we don't want to get involved in that. Let us first have our manager go out there and assess the property and see what's going on, and then we'll take further action.
Okay.
You brought up a lot of good points, but we don't get involved in who your realtor was and that. We're going to look at the situation at the house and deem it.
Okay, I have one more thing to add. I worked for 9 years in the city of West Palm Beach down in Palm Beach County. I know how municipalities operate, okay? If something, one of you all doesn't do something about this, because this is an abandoned home and she's just sitting on the property, once again, I'm not against her, but something has to be done about this because now my children are up here.
All right, sir.
It's a health hazard. I'll get in contact with Volusia County Health District, health.
We will too about the pool, sir, see what we can do about it.
I sincerely appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Vicki Whaley's.
Vicki Whaley's, 770 Gordon Court, Deltona. Your Honor, Commissioners, I have a concern. I think it was the last meeting, there was a discussion, brief discussion about a two times a week pickup for solid waste. To me, and I'm sure there are other singles, couples, and seniors like myself, to have someone come out to my residence and pick up solid waste twice a week would be simply a waste of gasoline, manpower. I may have four little bags a week. I don't need a week. I don't need a weekly pickup. And then it's going to be an expense. So why should every resident in Deltona be charged, and this extra pickup, which we do not need, if there are residents that generate a lot of solid waste, if they need two cans or if they need two pickups, then pick it up, assess them. But why should I pay, which I can't afford anyway? I'm senior on a fixed income.
We decided already, Vicki, we weren't going to do that.
You're not going to
do
it.
No, ma'am.
Thank
goodness. No, we're not going to have a double pickup.
Thank goodness.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Brandy White.
Good evening. Brandy White, Chalmers Street. I emailed previously on Friday each of you some proposals to solve the situation, especially, like she mentioned, the second trash day, it is unnecessary. I was a little surprised at some of the answers I got individually and how there's not a whole lot of unity on this. I actually prepared a whole spiel about my proposal, but right before my lunch break today, I had a surprise visitor at my desk. You guys are probably going to be very familiar with this because I told her to email and call each one of you about her situation. And it's a whole different step from the second bin issue. It's the bulk issue, which we all know still exists. I'm going to read a little bit of what she wrote me. She came to my desk because she recognized my name off of the Deltona website, the Facebook group we have, and she realized that she works with me. Again, you know, I've seen her in passing, but I don't really know her. So I was really surprised that she came up to me with her problem. And this is pretty much her problem. She became a homeowner on 7/28. Previous to that, she was a renter here in Deltona. She signed on her house, showed up the next day to find that the previous owner had dumped their stuff to the side of the road. Now, she called for bulk pickup, and they told her they would charge her. Her concern is she didn't buy a house with trash on the side of the road, so she didn't feel that that should be her issue. Fair enough. What she said she did is she called Waste Pro. They referred her to the city. And I have here, and I'll give you this too before I leave here, is a compilation of the completely different answers from so many different people on not only how it should be handled, but whose responsibility it is to handle it. She doesn't feel that it's her responsibility to handle the previous owner's trash. And she did want me to bring up that one specific issue she had on the renter side, it was moving out. She did her proper due diligence. She did everything she was supposed to do. She was down to 3 TVs. I asked her, how big were the TVs? 32-inch, 3 of them. She called for a special pickup. She wanted to let them know they'd be out there. They told her they would charge her for each TV over the first. Now, I don't know about you, but a 32-inch TV does not fit the same size as a dining room with chairs or a bedroom set. That's absurd for it to be charged per piece over something so small because it's one piece. And I did inform her that per the ordinance, she could get 2. That third, she was willing to pay, so she asked them, no problem, because she wasn't aware. How much do I owe you to come get these TVs before I move out? I don't want to leave them behind. It'll affect my lease. They couldn't give her an answer. They didn't have an answer. They referred her back to the city, and the city gave her 4 different answers. So she just wanted me to come up here and use my time, since she couldn't, to remind you that she's still waiting for an answer because fines are today and it's still sitting out there and she doesn't feel she should be fined.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
You got a copy of that, didn't you, Jane?
Yes, and I'm having...
Give it to the city clerk, please. You got a copy of that email.
Yes, and I'm having staff look at the issue. My understanding is that she did not want to call and schedule a pickup.
She did. I was there.
No, my understanding, but I will get down to the facts. My understanding is a different set of situations than what you have described.
All right. Well, have somebody check into it tomorrow and get her a firm answer from staff.
Gail Buck.
First of all, I live at 1350 Coronado Terrace, Deltona, Florida. Okay. I'm right across the way from number 7. That lady's house is at 1365 Indian Rock, not 1385. I have seen rats, raccoons, and a bear in right beside her house near the trailer. She has a trailer that's a disaster. I don't even think anybody can take it away unless they cut it up. It's a terrible, terrible situation. We've been complaining about it forever. And we keep getting told that they can do nothing about it.
Excuse me, I hate to interrupt you. I'll give you the time back, but what did you say your address was?
1350 Coronado Terrace.
Oh, Coronado,
I'm directly across from that woman on the golf course.
Okay, I understand now. So there's a trailer parked at the house plus the screen and the pool.
Oh, lots of crap. Crap.
Okay. Well, I don't want to... I won't comment. That's your
adjective.
And there is a
hole. There is a hole in that screen.
Okay.
If a child gets in there, they can drown.
Okay. The yard's not fenced?
Plus the other hazards. No, it is not.
Okay. That's...
No, it is not. You can walk from the golf course right up to her property. Yes, it is a mess.
Okay. Yeah.
The other thing I wanted to talk about was the trash.
Okay.
I came by today, and one of the barrels couldn't close the lid after the pickup. Trash is still there. Now, what are they supposed to do next week? The lid was open just maybe this far. They did not pick it up. I mean, it's like this every week. What are those people supposed to do with their trash next week?
They pick it up if the lid's only open a little bit.
No, they did not.
I don't.
Go up Alcam.
Okay, what's the address?
I have no idea. I just happened to notice it on my
way down. Is it the one on the vacant lot?
No.
By the commercial property there?
No.
Okay.
It is not. There's two of them on that street. One I can see. They also put something on top of it that probably should have went somewhere else. They just don't have enough room. They need at least two. A family of four needs at least two barrels. They cannot possibly get rid of all their trash with one. And what are we trying to do? Discourage young people from coming here? You just want old people like me here that hold one bag? It's crazy. Crazy. And what about those people that are only here 6 months of the year? Do they pay less because they're only here 6 months and have no trash? No, they pay the same as I do. Not fair. Why can't the families have more trash bins? I'm sorry, one isn't enough for some people. Two, if you have a family of eight, and I know there is a family of eight, they probably need three. I have one bag of trash a week. They could probably fill three bins. Sorry, but I think you should do it. And the only way we may have to do it is vote some of you out. I mean, we'll have to change it again.
Okay. All right.
I've seen this happen in my hometown, okay? And I was one of the people that people came to my business and poured their trash in my trash cans. And then I was charged extra. Is that right? Sorry. No. That's what's going to happen to you. In your city parks, people are going to empty their trash there. They're going to empty their trash at businesses. They're going to be a mess. Put it on empty lots, which I've already seen. Throw it in the river. Hey, up to you.
Thank you. That's it? Okay. All righty. Well, on the consent agenda this evening, next item is consent agenda item A is a request for approval of second amendment to the interlocal agreement for fire and rescue mutual aid within Volusia County, Florida. Any questions, comments from the commission on that one? Item B is a river to sea transportation planning organization funding agreement between the city and them for the next fiscal year. I got one speaker, Commissioner Vice Mayor.
Are there questions?
No.
All right. No questions. Okay. I make a motion to approve the consent agenda as published.
Okay. Commissioner Schleicher?
Second.
Okay. Would you allow us to vote, please? Okay. Commissioners, if you'd vote. All right. And a tally.
She wants to know if you asked for public participation on that.
That's a consent agenda item. Yeah, it is. Is there any public comment before we vote? No. Okay. I got the wrong something or other here. All right, motion carries 6-0. I was waiting for that to come up. All right, next item on the agenda is ordinance, public hearing, ordinance number 24-2016, Violin Reserve, RPUD, RZ15-006 at the first reading. Mr. Paradise is here sitting in for Mr. Bowley, or standing in for Mr. Bowley. Mr. Paradise, this had been postponed from the last meeting, and it had come to us with some comments by the P&Z, and could you update the commission on where we're at now
Yes, there was a continuance involved. That was at the request of the applicant. And on the 15th of June, the Planning and Zoning Board did hear this and recommended denial, but did provide some guidance or some comments along those lines. In the interim, city staff and the applicant have worked to update the master development plan and the written development agreement to address the comments brought forth by the Planning and Zoning Board. City staff does recommend that the City Commission adopt or approve Ordinance 24-2016 with those changes.
Okay, thank you. Can you, for the benefit of the audience and for the commissioner too, can you run through them quickly, the concerns that P&Z had? Because when we get a recommendation from them for denial and the applicant has gone out of their way to try to solve those, it leads us to want to explore deeper any concerns we may have, and I'd like you to just run through the
quickly go through them. One is the PZ felt that the project was underserved with amenity centers and suggested another amenity center be incorporated into the plan. Two was that they needed a little bit more open space, provide a pedestrian connection with the adjacent school, Osteen Elementary, remove a roadway connection to Collins Road and scale back the roadway connections just to one connection, which would be emergency access only. Provide opaque screening along Collins Road. There are several options ranging from a wall to 100% opaque landscaping. And again, those have been incorporated into the city's, to the project's development agreement. And there's also some language in there about a trail connection along the main entrance road.
Okay, thank you very much. Vice Mayor.
Thank you. I've got some concerns about P&Z's authority here. These six items, are they rooted in code? Was the project non-compliant with the land development code?
Not according to staff, and I don't think they found any non-code compliant elements. I think they were looking at trying to make the project better.
And I have some concerns about P&Z interjecting an opinion and rejecting a project based upon opinion rather than code and not having any interaction with this commission. There's a great deal of expense on the developer's side when they design a project and they design it to a variety of standards. But when it meets code, and our staff has reviewed that project for code compliance, I think I take exception to the fact that P&Z interjects an opinion that winds up resulting in a rejection by the P&Z unless you do these things that we want. I guess it's a process problem, and we need to seriously look at that. If we truly are going to be a business-friendly community, then we need to take a look at that process, I think, because I don't feel it's right for P&Z to reject a project based on their opinions rather than code.
Planning and zoning is a recommending body, and this is their recommendation. These plan unit development rezonings, by their inherent nature, have a degree of flexibility built into them. Your comments are understood, holistically, but with these plan unit developments. They are unique, and they can be custom tailored to suit specific projects.
I understand the PUDs. I was on the DRC for over 10 years.
Yeah.
Again, if it's if staff works out an agreement, that's one thing. But when that developer's agreement has been put together, the plans have been put together, and it's been determined it's code compliant, I have a problem with P&Z rejecting the entire project just based on some opinion issues. So I'm not picking on you, Mr. Paradise, at all. It's a process issue that maybe we need, as the commission, need to take up with the manager to look at. And I know some of it's rooted in law, you know, from the state of what P&Z's requirements are to do. I much rather would have some of those discussions take place with staff and try and get some feedback from the commission on some issues. I personally would rather see this project be more townhouses than having more single family residential in it. We have a ton of single family residential in the city, and we certainly could use an inventory of townhouses, I believe. So anyway, that's my
okay.
2 cents.
Commissioner Hertzberg?
I agree with Vice Mayor Nabig. P&Z is an advisory board, and they tend to veto a lot of things. They tend to negate a lot of projects that come through initially. And then when the commission goes through and approves them, then everyone wonders, well, why did we go against what P&Z said? But in this case, this was brought forth to the developer, and the developer, on P&Z's recommendation, changed what they had to do. And, you know, how much authority does P&Z have, and where is their expertise? And I understand they I'm assuming that staff goes in with it as well, but at what point does P&Z's authority override what the developer is bringing forth?
I think I'll defer some of the technical elements to the city attorney with regard to the process and their authority. They are a recommending body, and they're here to help provide guidance so that the city commission can have all the data needed to make an informed decision.
Okay, I think
they should they should recommend to this commission and to staff, not make recommendations to the developer. Because the recommendations may be something that's not compliant with the code.
Sir, if I could add one thing, Chris Boley, planning director. In the powers and duties afforded to the Planning and Zoning Board in Article 12 of the Land Development Code, there are
I'm back on now. Okay.
All
right. Be careful what you say now.
I'm a little worried now.
don't touch it.
I'm not touching anything. But just very briefly, there's only three alternatives, and I did talk about this to Ms. Vos before this meeting, and Mr. Vos can certainly attest to this, but the P&Z is only afforded three powers, as is given to it by the City Commission, and that's assigned in the code, and that is to approve straight away, approve with conditions, or deny. So what essentially happened was a fourth condition, which isn't part of the code, which is deny but with comment. You know, so just so you know, what we can do, and with the help of Mr. Vos, Ms. Vos, is we could at the next Planning and Zoning Board meeting, just have a review of those powers and duties so that an issue like this doesn't come up
again. I think Vice Mayor is right. All right, I'm going to let Commissioner Smith talk, and then I want to add something up. Go ahead, Commissioner.
Thank you, Mayor. You know, I hear what you're saying, but they are an advisory board, and they were advising what they felt would enhance the program. Well, if you look at their minutes, it says that, and it was in this agenda, that they cited, they did vote 0-5, but they cited that the proposed increase of dwelling units was where they had a problem with. They did request. Now, I'm sure the developer could have said, no, we're not doing this, and then it would have come to us to make that decision. I can tell you honestly, when I read this, I think it enhanced this project. I love, in fact, I'm leaving the commission soon. I might be buying a townhouse over there. I love this community. I love the idea of it. And I understand there's expenses that came with their recommendation, but I also think that it absolutely enhanced their right. And I think we're getting hung up in semantics. It was their suggestions, I believe. I don't think that they were able, and Mr. Boley or Mr. Paradise can tell me, they were suggesting that these changes be made. We could have easily said, no, it doesn't have to. Now, right. I understand that it kind of got caught up in that we never even heard the suggestions before this was, it was continued, but we never heard it before it actually came to us on paper, and the changes to the project had been made already. But I think, that's what we ask our advisory boards to do, is to look at projects.
I kind of agree. I think a total rejection of the project just outright for some technical reason would have made me more comfortable, because had the applicant not pulled this, I still was probably going to go against P&Z's recommendation, because the recommendation were things that, you hit the nail on the head, Commissioner Smith. We got a better project because of it. But I think if Mr. Boley yes. does go to them and explain to them, make approval based on recommendations is a lot better than total denial, because it gives us the impression there's something terribly wrong with this project for it to be 5-0. And so their opinions and their wishes, although they're well taken and we appreciate it, do not rise to the level of denying a project that's technically sound. So if you would just convey that, they work free and they do a great service, but sometimes that a total denial, it made me double check everything. It made us all do a little more homework on it. And I think we're going to have a better project. Commissioner Hertzberg, I'm sorry, you back up again, or was that just a...
Yeah, my comment was I agree the project is better. It's just the perception, again, of a complete denial, and then the commission goes ahead, and we've done this in the past, and we have park and rec advisory boards. If the advisory board says, no, we don't want to expand this park, does staff stop doing that and go back and consult with them without, at what level, and with this development, this is a cost. It's a cost to the developer.
Yep.
And that's where my question is in that. And I would respect more approve with conditions than a denial, because it is a continual denial with P&Z.
All right.
Thank
I agree.
You, Mayor.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Next, Timothy Van Camp. Mr. Van Camp. Sir, your name and address for the record?
Tim Van Camp, 470 Collins Road, Osteen, Florida, directly across from the planning development, or the development they're about to put in. I would like to say that only a shameless act of greed, would allow that many houses to wipe out all the wildlife that's there. I don't believe that the people that are doing the development understand how much wildlife is there and the crucial things that it's going to do to the ecosystem in our area.
Okay, thank you. Lori Warnicke? Warnicke? I'm sorry.
Good evening, Commission. Thank you very much for your time. I've been a lifelong resident of the city of Deltona since 1982. I have built and purchased three houses in the city. My final house is here in Osteen. I'm at 655 Lake Butler Avenue, which is at the end of the project. You guys have a clean slate. This is a project you guys can either approve or disapprove, but that whole 415 area, I am not against development whatsoever. But you have a clean slate. Let's do this right. We don't need a lot of houses on top of each other. Gino Pellucci was a fine man. He developed Lake Mary. It is now the number one city in the town. Everybody wants to live in Lake Mary. You can make it a ghetto, or you can make it a place where people want to live, work, and play. We sat here, we fought this 4 years, or in 2003 we fought this. They wanted to develop the pit, which is right across from it. That was denied. When we left this place, they had already approved a project with no access to Collins and a wall. Between now and then, things have changed again. I understand market went down, houses, nothing was developed. I am not against development. I'm against houses on top of each other. And you guys can do this, and you can do it right, and you can make us proud, or you cannot make us proud. This is a multifamily. We have partials from 1 acre to 3 acres to 5 acres to 11 acres to 40 acres. So you've got a multiple amount of people that live back there. Right now, 415 is a great road. It's ready for development. Let's not screw this up. Thank you.
Thank you. Want to speak? I thought we. Okay.
Good evening, and for the record, Michael Woods, law firm Cobb Cole, 351 East New York Avenue, Suite 200 in DeLand, here on behalf of the applicant. And that's kind of why I was jumping forward to give our presentation. I want to be brief onto the substance of what I was coming to talk to you about, but to address the overall concern and comment on the process and procedure with the planning board. One, first and foremost, I'd be happy to address or serve or volunteer on a discussion procedurally moving forward as you move forward with that. I don't think you're too far away. I think it's trying to provide just some clarity is I think what you're going to be looking for, both because for anybody, whether it's the residents, whether it's the applicant, whether it's the city, you want to know everyone's on the same page and kind of know what's going moving forward. I will also state on the record here that, yes, there were comments that came from the planning board. Yes, they'll probably add some cost. And if they were absolutely onerous, I guarantee you we would fight against what there was there. What has been proposed, because we got the 06 or 05 vote, we made the changes of our own free will and volition. We made the changes there because, and I'll get into a little bit of what our thought process was going into the planning board, but have no concern or rest assured that we're okay with what is being proposed now. There is some reference here, and you know that there is a project that was previously approved back in, say, 2007-ish, when the PD for this property was originally adopted, and there was a it was a different time back then. You know, the market being what it was, a different place. We've gone through this process in part because that PD, though approved at the commission, never got executed. You know, I wasn't familiar with who the previous property owner was, but rather than go through kind of the hoops of trying to verify not only the execution of that and how do you go forward and finalize that, but to also go back and address some of the conditions that were included at that time that now really no longer applied. 415 is a different road now. Collins Road is a different road now. We thought we'd take this opportunity to, one, and we're modifying for ourselves our lot size on the project itself for the lot size, but to also address some of the concerns that were brought to our attention that maybe didn't get addressed or weren't fully addressed back in 2007. And that would be predominantly the impact to the neighbors to the north to try to address some of their concerns. And you're going to hear more from the neighbors tonight. I'd ask the ability to respond to it. But the property is not going to remain vacant. There is entitlements on the property now. What we're trying to do, what you have before you, and in addition to some of the additional comments that came from Planning Board, is we've tried to soften the impact to Collins. The original project had the two access points. And in fact, the project that was previously adopted was intended to, I think, bring Collins down to Doyle. The neighbors didn't want that, mainly because they didn't want Doyle to come up to Collins. And, you know, Mr. Novick, I know you've got a background in the fire department. If it was our wish, we probably wouldn't have any connection to Collins whatsoever. But we have to have it for that emergency purposes. And so we've tried to focus as we work through staff. And this is a multi-month project, probably going 14, 15 months on and off. Some of it was slow on our part. Some of it was getting some more details with the staff. But the focus had always been external impacts. Are we doing something more to minimize or kind of soften the impact to the neighbors? Are we doing something that's responsive to the school? You've got the new access point to the school district now that will bring the students of this community can access the elementary school through a rear entrance rather than walking down our driveway and then across. And then just addressing the issues of the roadway and what was in place at the time the original document was adopted and where we are now. And I think what you have that was proposed even to the planning board was a pretty solid project as to those issues. Where I think we got called out of the planning board, and maybe rightfully so, was we didn't really focus on the internal amenities. Again, we were operating under the assumption, well, this project was pretty much already approved. We weren't really tweaking that much internally. But the ones that they brought up, the issues that they brought up, we thought were legitimate. So you now have two amenity facilities proposed, one servicing the townhomes, which was always there, an additional one for the single family. A trailhead's going to be put into place either as a separate standalone or part of that amenity center to allow these residents to eventually get down to the county trail that runs in the area. The access to the school property so that the kids can kind of stay within the project. And one of the other elements that I didn't do a very good job emphasizing to the planning board when we first went through was that western edge of our property, both originally proposed and now, is our tree preservation area and our retention pond. So yes, you've got your grid of homes kind of in the center there. Because that western portion, it's just the nature of the contour and the geography of the property. In most instances, you're building around wetlands or things of that nature. This is high and dry and cleared already. So we're putting the structures where they go and have the other area there to kind of, again, try to buffer or soften the impact to the west. Again, just to briefly summarize, I would emphasize that this is a project that provides a different kind of product. And, you know, there's the comments here, we'd like to have more townhouses. That's where I'd really love to have that conversation on process and procedure, because whether that was, you know, the will or not, you know, to hear that tonight for the first, you know, for the first time, or to not be able to have a clear kind of direction as to that, can be frustrating. I don't know what the answer is to that, to try to resolve that, but that would be a really good conversation to have. You've got a project that is located in close proximity to an elementary school, and you've got a project that I think is anticipating what's coming with the JPA. Yes, this is a project where you have this residential project going into a more rural area or less intense area, but I think that issue is already upon us, was already upon you in 2007, and I hope what we've provided to you addresses those concerns as best we can. Again, I'll reserve some time to respond to any comments as necessary and to answer any questions you may have. We do have our engineer with us and our traffic engineer as well.
Okay, thank you. Any comments, commissioners, or we'll go to the rest of the public who want to speak first?
Let the public speak, Mayor.
All right. Linda Patterson. Ms. Patterson, if you could just state your name and your address for the record, please.
I'm Linda Patterson. I live at 450 Collins Road, which is across from where you're trying to put this in. When I moved to Osteen 36 years ago, I didn't think I would be swallowed up by the city of Deltona. You took in our little community when you became a city. That's a different story. Years ago, you tried to put in the development, but it didn't happen. Now you're trying again. Do you expect the people at this development to travel on your road to get out onto Doyle Road? This will cause frustration when the people, they will want to find another way out. The developer has stated in his report there will be an all access to Collins Road needs to be limited for emergency vehicles only. Therefore, the access points on Collins Road need to be gated or otherwise impeded to only allow emergency access. What kind of guarantee are that the residents won't deduce a way to get through your gate? When the traffic out of the reserve to Doyle Road is backed up, the residents will be wanting to find another way out. If proposal comes to fruition, what will happen to the elementary schools walking along the sidewalks, which y'all have stated now you're going to have a separate area? Your development of 279 houses and 128 townhouses will be adding approximately 814 students to three schools, Osteen Elementary, Heritage Middle, and Pine Ridge High. Have you thought about the impact on the schools? Pine Ridge and Heritage have portables that are being used now. How many more portables will need to be added to accommodate the larger enrollment to the schools? The developer has stated in his report that the project will generate 3,497 trips per day in and out of the reserve. If you have 407 livable units and each unit has two vehicles, how was this figure projection made? The developer has provided several different tables that list trips in and out numbers, but the addition is off. Example, total in and out trips for houses is 2,699, and total in and out trips for townhouses is 797. When added together, the developer got 3,497. What new math adds 9 and 7 gets 7? In addition to the increase in population, you will also have to prepare for the increase in crime. These growing pains will directly impact the community, the schools, school transportation, law enforcement, and fire and rescue. Does each of these public services have the budget to expand? You annexed this land into your city 10 years ago. Are you planning to take over all of Osteen area west of 415? Is this city in such dire need to increase influx of money to help pay for your expenses? For example, we pay for your stormwater problems, which we don't have. In an email, it was stated there needs to incorporate some sort of signal warrant-oriented analysis at the project entrance on Doyle Road. The reply was, we will first analyze the intersection under stop sign control. If the intersection fails, then a signal warrant analysis will be conducted. If the analysis warrants a traffic signal, how will the residents from Cardinal Glen Road, which is dirt, be able to make the left-hand turn? Who will pay for the improvement? It was stated in the report there will be minimum lighting standards. What does this mean? Does this mean when I look up to the sky from my yard, I won't be able to see the stars? Finally, let me leave you with this thought. Are you wanting to get rid of all the flora to make us live in a city of concrete buildings and asphalt that will increase the temperature of the area and help increase your money into your budget?
Thank you, ma'am. Richard Taylor.
My name's Richard Taylor.
Your address?
My address is 268 Collins Road.
Right,
when the city of Deltona incorporated our property in 2004 with the promise of lower taxes, better service, and the promise of our property being zoned urban low density, which in our eyes meant one home site per acre. In 2007, all promises were broken. The city and zoning approved a neighborhood, Vineland Reserve, which had at least 8 homes per acre, plus townhomes, which were multifamily. Only due to the national recession, this neighborhood never took place. Let me remind you that this particular neighborhood is still on the real estate market and is up for sale as is for $3 million. Now, the same people want to add more single-family homes and townhomes. Since Vineland Reserve is up for sale as is, a platted neighborhood that was already zoned and approved in 2007, the residents that live on Collins Road are still not sure what that means for any of us. With the new zoning of Vineland Reserve to add more homes, townhomes, the residents of Collins Road main concern is the two access gates on Collins Road. We would like the developer to four-lane Dole Road from 415 to Cortland Road, which not only would ease all traffic, school traffic, but there would be no need to have an emergency vehicle gate access to Collins Road. Therefore, these gates can be eliminated permanently. We believe if there are gates on Collins Road, they will be breached because we cannot take the promise of the city's word otherwise. The residents of Collins Road know that eventually growth will take place. However, to build small homes with 10-foot backyards and to build townhomes with single garages in the middle of a cow pasture with no trees and nowhere for children to play spells trouble, either in foreclosures, bankruptcies, or in Section 8s. I believe Deltona already has a belly full of that. I would like to end this by saying, as long as those folks on Collins Road can have in writing a promise that these gates are deleted and that there will be no service entrance, no construction entrance, no emergency entrance, no vehicle entrance of any kind or walk-through gates, Collins Road, let me point out, has no sidewalks, streetlights, and has dangerous curves, steep hills, blind entrances, wildlife habitat, all of which cannot be obtained from any traffic from Vineland Reserve. I'd also like to point out that I am a state-certified building contractor, and I was at that zoning committee, and these guys that were up there were very intelligent and very knowledgeable. And the attorney over here did point out, and he admits that too, so they had homes where the tower was in distance of, if the tower fell, it would take out several homes. The sidewalks weren't wide enough. The streets were only 14 foot width. If somebody wanted to stop and talk to their neighbor, traffic was backed up. They realized that the traffic report probably wasn't what it's supposed to have been. They realized that it was going to be a big mess because the big school zones out there in front with the traffic coming in and out. My main concern is this neighborhood already has been approved in 2007. And it's right here. It's just been updated the 16th of last month. It's for sale. What's wrong with this neighborhood? Why do they want to add 50 more homes? Why is all this a big deal? They can't sell it like it is. This, you already approved it once. Now they want to add 50 more homes on us? None of that makes sense. You realize that these homes are building only have a 10-foot backyard? Have you ever heard of that? In the middle of Caulfield? Are you guys really paying attention here? You walk out your backyard and you take 10 steps and you're in your neighbor's yard, you know what's going to happen? They're going to put up little vinyl fences. And it's going to be like stockade out there. People aren't going to do that. This has ghetto roading on it. And that's a quote from one of the zoning guys up there. Like I said, the guys up there were very intelligent and they know what's going on and what's going to happen with this neighborhood. It was already approved for the neighborhood. The lots were the adequate size. Build it as is.
All right,
and
sir.
We'll live with it.
Okay, thank you very much. Appreciate it. Mr. Kenny Floyd, please.
My name is Kenny Floyd. I live at 3070 Butler Ridge Road, which is the county of Volusia, but to the west of that, I joined that property. I'm also the owner of Seminole Paving in Sanford, Florida. And knowing roads, development, that kind of stuff, what happens, that road out there, Collins Road, will not, I mean, not Collins Road, won't handle any traffic, but Dole Road as it is, we just spent, how much money did the county just spend widening that road? That's still not applicable enough to handle the traffic flow we have, I mean. And the schools itself, I have a daughter who goes to that school, the schools are crowded, so what are we going to do, build more schools? We don't have the money for that. I mean, it's just, leave it as is. If it's in there, it's in there. It's going to be nothing but ghetto in the end. And I don't know if you're aware of where I live and what I bought, but I bought where I bought for a reason, to live in the country. I have race cars. They make noise. I'm in the county. I'm not in the city. I have different rules than they have. So do you want to have the cops come into my house every week because I fire a race car up? Because I'm going to do it. That's why I bought where I bought for. You know, I spent my money, and I've developed my place for what I want because that's what I'm allowed to have. And therefore, now you put something behind me, them woods aren't enough buffer. They're going to be calling, complaining. My whole neighborhood has race cars or airboats or stuff like that they work on until hours that we're allowed to work on, too. So your rules are different than our rules. So what's that going to make? It's going to make more problems, more phone calls, more people complaining. I mean, not to count, if you haven't been back there, the turtles and the wildlife they talk about, there's a ton of turtles on that property. I can't even build a pump house on my house, on my property, without getting wetlands permit or turtles, you know, checked on every time I do something. And I know about there, there's at least 40 turtle holes in that area, in that cow pasture and everywhere else, that if it is developed, it needs to be removed properly and not just dug and disappeared. So thank you very much for your time.
All right. Thank you, sir. Okay. Is there anyone else that wants to speak? It will close the public hearing portion. Access Road, Collins. I've got Vice Mayor here, but I don't want to ask him. Well, I guess I can. There's a lot of concern about that gates on the access road. Mr. Paradise, you want to reiterate what you said about that?
Yeah, the access road or the emergency access would be gated. The fire department would have access to those gates, but it's been my experience that gates are very well respected, and the traffic patterns will reflect that by directing all the traffic down to Doyle Road.
As I understand it, unless I'm wrong, that's similar to what we did out here where we put that hardened road in with the grass over the top, and so it looks like a grassed area.
It's not an uncommon approach.
Okay, it's what we've got out here on the edge of our... Okay. All right, Commissioner Sukup?
Yeah, that goes back to my question back on the Collins Road. We have to have that back there? Can't you push all the traffic to the front?
All the traffic will be pushed to the front. It's not the intent for that access to be used as...
But you said not intended. If I buy a house there, can I go out the back gate?
No.
No.
Okay. You won't have access.
You won't have a key to the fence.
That's correct.
Commissioner Hertzberg?
Thank you, Mayor. So what is the reality of, since the county, Doyle Road is a county road, what is the reality of any more widening or anything going on there? Do we have any idea?
No, I think there have been some discussions, but nothing definitive.
And would this project push that to the forefront? Because I mean, I agree that it definitely, something needs to be done in that area as 415 develops.
Not right now. It is, I believe, on a county long-range plan for eventual four-laning.
And then I have questions on the gopher tortoise mitigation. I understand definitely there are gopher tortoises on that property.
There are.
And what is the...
Relocation. It's the only option. And there's a city policy that enumerates that.
So there will be gopher tortoise relocation.
And any other protected species. So.
The site will have to be surveyed for protected species. But, yes, there are gopher tortoises there. They were noted during a site visit to the site.
And density-wise, all this falls in with all the rules that were back in 07, as looking through the...
There has been an addition of 61 single-family dwelling units, which, doing the arithmetic, it's about a tad under 4 units per acre and comports with the underlying land use density.
I mean, on a personal standpoint, I don't disagree with the people, I mean, that are speaking. Development is never easy, especially when it's in your backyard. But, you know, we all know Deltona has tiny little postage stamp lots, and there's a lot of issues between neighbors and code issues and renting issues and everything on those small lots. I mean, when you have no buffer, you have no nothing. Is there an HOA proposed with this?
Yes.
And how is that going to be handled?
The covenants and restrictions and the bylaws of the HOA have not been drafted, but there is a requirement for the city to review those bylaws when they do get drafted.
Is the last thing we want to do is get into another situation where HOAs fall apart, and then, you know, you have road issues, you have everything else, as happened with some of the communities that have history in Deltona. All right, thank you.
All All right, Vice Mayor.
Does this trip a TIA?
Yeah, oh yeah, there was a TIA done, and then the city had peer review on it. So there's been two traffic planning outfits look at this, as well as staff internally. So, you know, they did their own TIA. It was reviewed independently by BCC, which is a city contractor. Also, city staff, of course, looked at this traffic information as well.
And what was the analysis with regards to Doyle?
There need to build turn lanes with adequate storage to get people out of the travel lanes for ingress and egress.
And the developer's going to...
Oh, yeah, they will take care of that. And Doyle Road, of course, is a county road, and that will all be, the exact dimensions and design will be arrived at as part of the county's use permit process, of which the city will be a very active backseat driver if needed. Forgive the pun.
Okay, I just wanted, I know that, I just wanted to bring that out. And I would assume there's been concurrency done already with the school board?
Yes, they were required to work with the school district, and there are no capacity deficiencies out there with regard to the schools in the area.
Okay. And just to clarify the issue with regards to Collins Road, both the land development code and the fire code require that you have two points of access and or egress. If something were to happen to the main road off of Doyle Road coming in a hurricane, a wildfire, whatever the condition may be, emergency vehicles and the occupants of that subdivision would need a second point of egress or ingress to it. So that's the reason for that, and that'll be gate controlled for the emergency vehicles to be able to come in. But that's a code requirement, both a land development code and a state fire code requirement. That's all I've got right now.
All right, sir. Commissioner Ertzberg, you got another comment?
I do. I have one more question just on process. The gentleman talked about that he, you know, lives in the county area and he has, you know, noise issues he's got property, whatever he does. And now with a community like that coming in, even if there are the complaints, I mean, that's a county jurisdiction. So we don't, I mean, what is the recourse? I mean, do you forward the complaint to the county? I mean, we as a city don't do anything for that. I mean, just...
We'd have to refer to the county. They'd be the one I'd have to refer to.
And okay, that's... I just want that clarified. It wouldn't be the city enforcing anything like that.
Now, Ron, you guys look at the property that the gentleman was talking about, is there adequate buffer?
There is a 20-foot buffer, perimeter buffer planned for the project.
What type of buffer are we looking at? Just vegetation, or are we looking at berm?
It depends on what segment. Along Collins Road, there is enhanced buffer requirements. The rest of the buffers will be compliant with the city's land development code 808, 110-808. The only berm that would occur would be an option along the Collins Road corridor.
Okay, thank you.
All right, Commissioner Smith.
Thank you, Mayor. Mr. Paradise, I just pulled up the minutes of the meeting where this was discussed, and it's been referenced a lot. The part we have in our agenda is shorter than what the minutes say. This is talking about the concurrency. You said that the concurrency study already happened with the school board?
Yes.
Is that what you said?
Yeah.
Okay, because this says high school and middle school. Why wasn't the elementary addressed in the concurrency study? There used to be a letter that came from Sarah Lee Morrissey, and it listed the number, because someone mentioned 800 students. I don't know where that number came from, and maybe it came from that letter. But we did not see a copy of that letter. How is Osteen Elementary being impacted? Is it going to change?
I'll let Chris.
I was there that night for the P&Z, and so the question from the P&Z member, and I can't remember which one it was. I think it was
Mr.
Ilesimbo, but I'm not sure. Anyway, he just specifically asked about middle school and high school because the middle school is nearby and the high school is to the north. So he asked about those two, and I just responded back to him that there was capacity at both of those.
But we received the letter. What is the impact on Osteen Elementary?
We get back from Sarah Lee saying that there are student stations available. So for
and those, she said it is available in the elementary school as well.
Right. Yes.
Normally that letter indicates no impact to Volusia County schools. It doesn't specify.
No,
a number
specifies
for each,
the schools.
Does it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but
it does,
I mean, in the air, but it doesn't schools. Give a number, does it?
Yes.
It has what's available?
Well,
it'll say capacity is available, and it'll list the schools.
Okay.
Right.
So it just says that student stations are available.
Okay.
And it'll list the schools.
Stations. All right. Okay, anyone else? All right. Are there any closing remarks? We've already closed the public hearing, sir. You can't speak from back there. You'll have to come up to the podium. I'll allow you to make a 30-second comment, if you will. Sir, I know, and that's why I'm allowing you to do it. And your name and address for the record again. We have
3070 Butler Ridge Road, Kenny Floyd.
Okay.
As far as that west line, a 20-foot buffer, do you realize media use probably more than 20-foot? I mean, that's not much of a lands buffer at all, So they're going to wipe out every tree. The only trees that are on that property are on that west line pretty much. They're going to take all the rest of that vegetation out. It needs to be more of a buffer. The other thing that might help out on the road.
I would allow you one comment. I can't do this.
On your back fire entrance, as he's an ex-fireman and I build roads, you don't have to put pavement back there. You can do a stabilized road that we do at
schools. That's what we're talking about, sir.
Let these people know that it's available.
They know it. We have one right here. I refer to the one right on the side of the building. It's paved, grassed over, and it's exactly what you're speaking of. That's, I think, what you had anticipated anyway, was it not?
Sir, we don't have that. We don't have that detailed plan in front of us.
Yeah, that's
staff typically does that. The developer likes to do a stabilized surface because it's cheaper for them to install and it looks better.
And it's right here on the other end of our buildings. Yeah, we're from. Sorry, I can't do that. I'm sorry. But no, sir, I'm not. I'm trying to be as polite as I can. We don't normally let anyone speak. Okay. Do you have any further comments? Okay. If there's no other questions or comments, motion's in order. Commissioner Hertzberg?
I'm sorry. I just have another comment. It's on the landscape buffer, and if we don't want to address it now, we can address it if this goes through the first time. I'd like to see a larger landscape buffer in that back end.
Right.
I'm pulling up 110-808 right now and trying to go through what we list
this
there.
This is first reading? Yes.
Yeah. I mean.
Okay. All right. Vice Mayor Novick.
I hereby move that ordinance number 24-2016 be approved at first reading, with the recommended changes to the RPUD program to include comments from the Planning and Zoning Board.
Okay. It's probably moved by Vice Mayor, Commissioner Schleicher.
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Schleicher. Mr. Voss, would you read the ordinance, please?
Thank you, Mayor. Ordinance number 24-2016, an ordinance of the City of Deltona, Florida, rezoning and amending the official zoning map for approximately 102.7 acres of land with a City of Deltona Residential Plan Unit Development, RPUD, to RPUD located between Doyle Road and Collins Road to allow for an increase in the number of units and project redesign, providing for conflicts, severability, and an effective date. And this
Thank
is
you,
its
sir.
First reading.
Thank you. Would you allow us to vote, please? Motion 6-0 for approval. Move on to the next item on the agenda. It's item number 9B, and it's a request for approval of adoption of final assessment resolution number 2015-41 for the creation of the Arbor Ridge Phase 5 Street Lighting District. Public Works, Mr. Chancellor, worked through this. This is a project that has only one representing signature because it's a developer's request for move it forward. So anybody have any questions, comments? Anyone in the public want to speak for or against this? This is for a street lighting district in phase five of Arbor Ridge. As best as we could understand here for the technical tuck, it'll match what's currently there. Commissioner Schleicher?
If nobody has any comments, I'm ready to make a motion.
Yeah, we'll close the public hearing. Go ahead.
I move to adopt the final assessment resolution number 2015-41, creating the Arbor Ridge Street Lighting District, and to schedule the public hearing.
All right, Vice Mayor?
Second.
Okay, it's been properly made and seconded. If you would allow us to vote, please. Okay, the motion passes 6-0. Next item, that's all of the next old business. There's none tonight. Ms. Shang, there's no old business. You're aware of?
No.
Okay, under new business, a request for approval of DEP agreement NF-004 with the Florida Department of Environmental Protection, from state grant being awarded to Brickell Regional Surface Water Treatment Facility. Again, this is a project cost of $605,000 with $363,500 being funded by the grant. Is there any questions by anybody in the public want to have any questions concerning this? Okay, we'll close the public hearing. Commissioner Hertzberg?
I move to approve the execution of DEP agreement number NF-004.
Okay.
Mayor, I just have a quick question. Is this grant as a result of anything to do with our lobbyist?
Well,
is this grant as a result of any efforts from our lobbyist?
No.
No? Okay.
No.
I'll second.
Okay, it's been made and seconded. I should let you know that I did talk to the lobbyists. I mean, I know the question you're asking was a direct result. I don't know, but I did talk to about some of these things.
I just try to keep a mental tally of projects that the lobbyist firm has had influence on.
They may have done something with DEP that I'm not sure of, but I just, I know we talked about some of the things that were in the hopper. Had a motion and a second. Would you let us vote? Motion passes 6-0. Okay, the last item on the agenda this evening is consideration of Commissioner Hertzberg's appointment to Parks and Recreation. Have you had a chance to make that recommendation? Okay. Would you like to let us know who it is?
Would you like me to do that in the form of a motion?
You can, ma'am.
I would like to appoint Giselle Sierra to the Park and Rec Advisory Board.
All right. It's been properly moved by Commissioner Hertzberg for appointment of Giselle Sierra. Commissioner Schleicher?
I'll second that motion.
All right. Motion has been made and seconded. Would you allow any more comments? Seeing none, we'll go ahead and vote. All right, motion passes 6-0. Mr. Voss, you got any comments tonight?
I've got no comments tonight, Mayor. Thank you.
Okay. Ms. Shang?
No, sir.
Okay. City Commissioner, Commissioner Smith, would you like to start us off?
Thank you, Mayor. I just have one comment. It is a follow-up on our meeting, our special meeting last week regarding solid waste ordinance. We are going to have a budget workshop on the 11th of August. We are looking again at that surplus, the expenditure request from the city manager regarding some of our surplus. I'd like us to look at that closely And I did address this with the city manager, so this isn't a surprise. I'd like us to consider purchasing the second bin for any of our residents that want one. I think that through the automation or through our ordinance, and I spoke about this the other night, I think the unintended consequence of that was we took away the ability of our citizens to be able to use that second bin that they might have had, but it doesn't fit on the automated truck. I truly don't believe there are lots of folks that are going to request that, but I think it is a service to our community that we need to consider. All I'm asking is that we consider it that night. What's that? Okay, well, not asking you to make a decision.
You just want to bring
it up. I'd like us to discuss it on the 11th.
Okay.
And then just, we need to lock down those fees as far as what's being told to folks regarding the pickup and how much they're pay, if they have to pay, how much. I think we heard tonight there's still lots of confusion out there. I think there's confusion about the fines. I didn't know. I had to ask the city manager, what exactly, if I leave a bag on the side of my trash bin and it's not picked up, what am I paying? And I found out if it's a bag and it's not picked up and I don't get it in the bin, it'll be a fine of $156. That's a lot of money, and we need to make sure that folks are aware of the fines. Now, that's for one bag. If I have a lot of other stuff out there, that part could go up. There's an administrative fee of $100. That's given. You're paying $100. But then the amount goes up depending on what you've left outside and if you did not pick it up and get it in your bin for the following week. So those are the two things I'd like us, well, the bin I'd like us to address at our budget workshop. I'm just asking that we move very quickly to get those fines, get the fees, the pickup fees settled, and let's get them adopted.
Clarify, it's $28 per cubic yard, so there's a minimum fee of two cubic yards, which is why you have the $56 plus the administrative fee.
For a special pickup.
For a fine. For an abatement.
And what time frame is given for that abatement? How much time are someone given to remedy that?
Yeah, that's what we need. You're allowed, they notify you, you get 24
hours,
to remove
today
it.
Someone had called me on what they had issues with, and they were given 7 to 10 days. So I think we need clarity.
Okay. All right, you want to get some information? Yeah. Okay, Commissioner Sukup? Commissioner Hertzberg?
Just one quick comment. I would like this commission to go ahead and when we talk about the trash things, as a separate side note, you know, this trash beautification has brought up a lot of other issues or several other issues regarding homes that are not kept up. And if we're going to go ahead and do this much time and effort in trash, we need to really strongly look at how we deal with homes and renters and homeowners that don't comply, like this gentleman that was here with this house. We have houses that I asked for a list today on one home, how many violations are in this one home, and they have cars parked all over the place, and the comment the code enforcement officer made was, mulch your front yard next to your driveway and you'll be in compliance. And I also want to address this fact that you have a driveway and all you have to do is put mulch or something down next to it and you can go ahead and you don't have to do a permit for that. You don't have to do anything and you're in compliance. Now talk about what we just talked about with this new project going in and how small those lots are. And when you're looking at that, look at the little Deltona two-bedroom, one-bath Mackle homes and you've got a little driveway and then you've got mulch here and mulch in the front yard. I mean, how is that a beautiful city? I really, really strongly am going to ask this commission in a public hearing to look, let's look at what our code allows and why are we allowing some of these things to happen on these tiny lots and you can mulch away and you can park anywhere. That's not solving the problem of four pickup trucks in your front yard for your neighbors. I mean, I just would really like to have, I'm not going to stop until that's addressed. And the same with the code enforcement things being addressed to the tenant that lives there. If you have 16 violations on the house and the landlord hasn't received one because they're parking violations, they're animal violations, and they're trash violations, how come the landlord doesn't receive any of that? And if I'm wrong, I'll get clarification from staff, but I really would like the city to reevaluate at some time how we deal with the messy houses and the rentals and the people that don't comply with regular things. And let's start holding the homeowner, the property owner, accountable for who they rent to and what kind of trash goes on in their property. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you, ma'am. Commissioner Schlager.
First of all, I think Monday night's workshop on the budget, we can talk about that, but I also think, isn't that the enterprise fund and other funds?
The
11th, because just to let people know, on the 11th is a big budget meeting for 5:30. So people know it, it's at 5:30 on the 11th. But they also have a workshop on Monday the 8th talking about budget, but those are other special funds. I do want to tell and remind everybody, tomorrow night is National Night Out, honoring our deputies. I know that's too bad. And a special thanks to New Hope Baptist Church. We had an opportunity to go over to see some of the students who had some wonderful projects they did during the summer. They did a fabulous summer program, and I look forward to them doing much more with our students. And I just want to say thank you to them for their efforts at having that summer program for our youngsters.
Thank you, ma'am. Vice Mayor.
Thank you, Mayor. Just in response to Commissioner Hertzberg's comments about rentals. Again, a lot of our problems are rental properties. We did away with our rental ordinance. That needs to be revived. It needs to be strengthened. Rental property is a business. It's a business. Somebody is making an income off of that. And we need to treat it like a business. We need to tax it like a business. There's a revenue stream to deal with that problem to help pay for code enforcement. But until we do that, until we address the rental property problem, we're chasing our tail here. I brought up at the agenda review upstairs, and I want it on the record down here then. Two things. One is, whenever this commission meets as a body, whether it's a citizens forum, whether it's a commission meeting, a workshop, whatever, whenever we officially gather together for purpose of a meeting, if we host a League of Cities meeting, if we host a mayor's roundtable, if we host a summit, a West Volusia summit, law enforcement needs to have a presence at the meeting. In this day and time, we need to have a deputy here.
We all agree. Yeah, it should be.
It was an oversight. I just want it formalized as policy, and that's what happens.
Okay.
That way, if it's an oversight again, somebody's held accountable. And then also the DTV. When we meet in the chambers here together as a group, as the commission, again, whether it's for a workshop, a forum, or whatever, we spent a lot of money on that television station. We're about transparency. We talk about transparency. People now expect that if they can't come to a meeting, that they should be able to see it live on television. If it's in the chambers, that's the only place we have the ability really to record it. Certain things could be recorded off-site, but when we gather together here, we've got the ability for staff to do that. Yes, there is a slight expense to do it, but I think it's important we talk about getting information to our citizens. Sometimes we had that one meeting here. It was pouring rain outside. I think a lot of people didn't come because of that. So
I think you got total support. So that's
thank you. That's all I've got tonight,
staff. All right, thank you very much. And Ms. Schlager stole some of my thunder, but I'm going to go through a couple of things first. Anybody that has the time or would like to, Agueda Ramirez is celebrating her 104th birthday tomorrow at Deltona Healthcare up here on the corner. I don't know. I wasn't asked to do this, but sure would be nice if you had the feeling or if the spirit moves, you drop a card off for her. Ms. Ramirez is going to be 104 tomorrow, so I'm going to try to stop by and pay my respects to her and her family. But between 1 and 12 and 2, I think. I'm not inviting everybody there because they're not prepared for that. But if you'd like to drop off a card or whatever, it'd be kind of cute. It's not many of us can meet that milestone. Also, commissioners, I did talk to you. Ms. Dombrowski from Forest Lake, any of you will be able to speak to the students on the 10th of October. I'll let her know tomorrow. One other thing, I prepared a letter, and I'll read it, and if there's any questions, I'll get with you. It says, from the City of Deltona, support for Enterprise Preservation Society traveling exhibit The Way We Work. To the Florida Humanities Council, the City of Deltona supports the efforts of the Enterprise Preservation Society in obtaining The Way We Work traveling exhibit for the Enterprise Heritage Center and Museum. The city will assist in publicizing and promoting this exhibit by featuring it in our announcements on RTV, DTV, and making promotional items provided to us, to our residents in the city. This is a great event. This is a traveling thing, and they're requesting it, and I think it's something that would help us. It's going to get our name out there. This also may be a way to get our new movie star, Ms. Hertzberg's little 3-minute that went into 10 minutes. Jane teased me about 3 minutes. But that'd be a good place to show that out. And it's a very worthwhile. And without any objections, I'm going to forward this on to them to support them getting this traveling exhibit. So if you'd pass that down to the city manager, she'll take care of that. And that's the signed letter for them. And Commissioner Schleicher was so quick to say, but I want to try to get all of you to come out tomorrow night between 5:30 and 8:30. It's a national night out. It gives us an opportunity to really support our deputies. We don't have our own police force, but we fondly think of them as our police force. And with all that's going on in this country, I don't need to tell you, they need a pat on the back every now and then. And so the commission was gratefully accepted a proposal I had, and Commissioner Shang and the Parks and Recreation and the team of Steve and Sean, as you're leaving tonight, you won't be able to see it because it's purposely in the dark. But tomorrow night at 8 o'clock, we will light up our two stars out front and our blue line flag, and you'll be quite impressed with it, I'm sure. And I'd hope you'd all come out tomorrow night. And it's between 5:30 and 8:30. And we look forward to seeing you here. I'm not sure, is there going to be food or food carts or hot dogs by the fire department usually? Usually, or the sheriff's? Okay, so there'll be some snacks anyway. So please come on out. I know it's hot, but if you wait till 5:30, 6 o'clock, it starts cooling down. So come on out. We'll spend the evening, and at 8 o'clock, we'll have the lighting of the stars out front for our deputies. And all during the month of August, we are going to set the entire month aside to do special recognitions of our deputies and what they do for us and protecting us here in Deltona. So all kind of little things, little blue ribbons. If you don't have a blue light bulb, put a blue light bulb in your porch light, similar to the green one we did for veterans. So my yard is starting to look kind of colorful. I got a green one on one side, a blue on the other. But just to let them know when they're driving around at night that you're thinking of them. So it helps even if you just put it up temporarily. But it's in my case, I'll leave it up all the time. I think it's a good reminder to them that blue light's out there for them. So publicly, thank you guys. I think one of them is still here for what you all do for us. Please send the word out and try to make it tomorrow night. There being no other business, we stand adjourned.